NASA has selected a contractor to develop the next human landing system for the moon, and the winner is SpaceX. Let's talk about that.
Go for deploy. 100 feet, lift into the right lane. Contact right. The Eagle has landed.
Hey guys, Tori here from Overlook Horizon. On Friday, April 16th, NASA decided to drop an unexpected bombshell on the space world by announcing the winner of the Human Landing System, or the HLS contract, and that exciting award goes to SpaceX and their lunar Starship design. Now, this was a bit unexpected. If you remember, back in May of last year, I actually talked about how many in the aerospace community were surprised that Starship was even included in consideration, given that their approach is way different from everybody else. Both Blue Origin and Dynetics, who were also competing for this contract, were proposing landers that looked way closer to something like the Apollo lunar lander and not the gigantic Starship. There was also, of course, the money factor. Many people thought that SpaceX wasn't being given real consideration because when you look at the dollar amounts that were awarded last year to develop their proposals, SpaceX was given $135 million, while Dynetics got $235 million and Blue Origin got $579 million. Now, NASA was very careful to say that the dollar amounts were not playing favorites and that they were just indicative of the development work that the providers were going to do over the last year. But it didn't stop people from talking about it. And in the end, though, it seems that the low-cost dollar amount is one of the main factors that NASA really liked, but I'll get to that in just a minute. Now, the Option A contract could have been provided to one or more commercial partners. Actually, it could have been provided to none, but obviously that wasn't the case. It was expected that they would pick two. It's definitely beneficial to have some redundancy, so in case something happened with one provider, NASA could continue with their missions through another provider. This is the main reason why we have both the SpaceX Crew Dragon and someday the Boeing Starliner sending astronauts to the International Space Station. However, NASA only awarded one contract, which was actually not their initial preference. In the determination document itself, Kathy Leaders even stated that they would prefer two Option A contracts to promote redundancy along with competitive pricing and timelines, but based on NASA's budget allocation and the proposed costs, they determined that they would just go with one. And the cost of SpaceX's proposal? $2,941,394,557. This is weirdly specific. I don't know why. I don't do government contracts, but they're going to get $2.9 billion. But don't forget that extra $557. Either way, NASA said that SpaceX's proposal was way less expensive than anyone else. Blue Origin was the next highest by a wide margin, and Dynetics was even higher than that, also by a wide margin. The main reason for this is because SpaceX has decided to self-fund and assume financial risk for over half of the development cost and testing activities. That's pretty much what they're doing already with all their private initiatives like the Starlink satellites, along with private missions like the Dear Moon mission and the Inspiration 4 mission, which can all help raise additional funds and allow them to invest in themselves. But cost is not the only good thing about SpaceX's Starship. This contract was evaluated on three conditions: technical, pricing, and management. In that order of importance, NASA noted that SpaceX exceeded their requirements in many areas. I mean, just look at the size of this thing. The amount of payload that Starship can carry is far higher than what NASA required, but don't forget, it's only acting as a lander for NASA. NASA still expected to launch crew on the SLS rockets with astronauts inside the Orion capsule, and then they will meet up in lunar orbit with the Starship before descending to the moon. But another benefit for Starship is that SpaceX says that the Starship can stay in lunar orbit for up to 100 days while waiting for the crew to arrive. This is 10 days longer than what NASA required. NASA wants a nice margin here so they can put a lander in lunar orbit and then have some flexibility in the crew launch schedule. Now, once on the surface, the Starship proposes to have both pressurized and unpressurized cargo spaces, standalone habitation capabilities, extended capabilities for surface EVAs, and even two separate airlocks. But they did note some concerns. The Starship proposal is very complex. We all probably could have guessed that by watching the recent test flights, but the new render does show some nice Falcon 9 looking legs, which is new. But one of the main complexities is that in order to reach the moon, it will need to perform multiple in-space propellant transfers from a tanker starship while it's in Earth orbit before it heads to the moon. In-space propellant transfer alone could be a challenge, and it's risky, but the upside here is that it all happens in Earth orbit, which is easier to do and easier to manage contingencies than if it was being done in lunar orbit. And SpaceX is going to demo that capability first. But even if they nail that, just managing the multiple vehicles needed for a lunar mission could be a logistics challenge. NASA also noted that once on the surface, the crew hatch is going to be 30 meters off the surface. That means they're going to need some sort of elevator or something. And even with that, what sort of backup plan is there if something breaks? Blue Origin and Dynetics had proposed vehicles that were obviously much smaller, so they would simply have a ladder or a few steps. But their proposals had some issues too. Blue Origin was the second choice, but their proposal had some concerns with their level of technical readiness in their designs, and they also did something weird, which was to ask for advance payments prior to completing the work, which is something that automatically disqualified them from receiving a contract. Now, NASA could have negotiated with them on that, but given NASA's lack of budget and SpaceX's huge cost savings, they decided not to. Dynetics was choice number three, and they had a weight problem. More specifically, their lander had a negative mass allocation, which essentially means that the lander is too heavy from the start, and they would need to find weight savings during development. This had NASA doubting whether or not they could deliver on their proposal. But mostly, it came down to cost and budget. If NASA's budget was higher, they likely would have tried to include Blue Origin as a second provider. Now, this initial contract provides for SpaceX to perform an uncrewed demonstration landing first, and then one crewed landing after that. From there, they'll need to win the Option B contract to proceed with long-term recurring missions, and who knows? Maybe at that point, NASA will be able to bring on some other providers, because I do think that having some redundancy is better in the long run to ensure we don't have any interruptions in our future missions to the moon. Unfortunately, there's already a few people that are upset with this decision, but I think it would be great if the new incoming NASA administrator could lobby for additional funds and then include a second provider now. Wouldn't that be awesome? So what do you guys think? Do you agree with this decision? Let me know in the comments down below. And I will see you in the next video. Goodbye. Also competing for this contract, we're proposing.